What is life? You can start.
Yes. Anup, you can go ahead.
Okay. So good evening, one and all the respected seniors, especially Dr. Bhinde sir, for joining us this evening, and all my colleagues and all the viewers across Ortho TV. It's our privilege to have Dr. Bhinde sir to speak on a very, very important topic for this episode. We talk of whatever we do inside the theater. I guess, especially for TKRs, what we do outside it is also very important, especially pain management, thromboembolism prophylaxis, physiotherapy protocols, when do you change your dressings, what functional achievable targets are we realistically looking at. So all these are questions that actually come in surgeon's mind once he leaves the theater. So I'd like to invite Dr. Harish Bhinde, sir. Certainly requires no introduction, a very eminent joint replacement surgeon in India. And we'd like to hear from sir regarding what tips and tricks are we to do to have a successful joint replacement practice. All over to you, sir. So, can you unmute?
Okay. Can you hear me on?
Yes, sir, we can.
Hello?
Yeah, yes, sir, wonderful. We can hear you.
Thank you, Anup, and thank you, OrthoTV, for inviting me to this young orthopedic surgeons forum. I think it's a great idea that you have a small talk and then we have got a discussion with a younger colleague who have done a lot of good surgeries. And then we analyze them, how they have done, they can tell us, and we can share the experiences. And it's a great idea. So I was told to talk about what happens to a patient or what should happen to a patient after the patient goes and walks out of your surgery theater. So let me share the screen. Okay, the topic is my TKR outside the OT. So I'm not going to talk to you about what happens in the OT, but exactly we are done the surgery, you have done the replacement surgery, which is now not a very specialty operation as such. About 60% orthopedic surgeon, especially the newly trained one in the last 5 years, are doing themselves. It may not be a big number, but most of them are taking it as a more or less a routine surgery. But what matters is unless you have got a good number and unless you've got a big experience, which comes sometime at a cost of some bad experiences, you are not aware about what needs to be done, because there is a one big difference between the trauma surgery and a replacement surgery. And I always tell my younger colleagues that many of them start the practice as a trauma surgeon because that's very easy to come. And then they graduate to arthroplasty when they go into private practice. And that is why you are trained with a trauma surgery. The difference between trauma and arthroplasty is that in arthroplasty, you normally get the only one chance, and the first chance has to be the best chance. You cannot say, like, for example, in a trauma cases, we have got a fracture tibia that let me first nail the fracture and see if it heals. And if it doesn't heal, well, I can go back and do grafting or I can do exchange nailing. And if it still doesn't heal, I may go back and remove the nail and put a plate on the bone. And suppose if it gets infection, I can just remove the plate and put an external fixator, remove all the necrotic thing, maybe do another grafting, maybe a cross leg flap. And in the end of the day, if still doesn't work, I can still do ELISARA, get the fixation, get the bone healing. It may be 2 years from now, but the patient will still walk for the rest of his life. I would say not near normal, but at least 80% of his normal activity. It doesn't happen like that in a knee replacement. You get one chance and that chance gets screwed up. The second surgery for anything, either instability or second surgery for severe pain or infection, which is more common, leaves the patient even in a best case scenario with a partial outcome. The patient will never be happy when he has undergone a revision surgery. And if it is a second or third revision, then that patient will be in a really big trouble. So the surgeon has to have a change of mindset when they are doing knee replacement surgery, that this is going to be the first and probably the best surgery for the patient. And that's why a lot of the time we are not sure about what to do and how to handle the situation when after the surgery, when the patient is out of the theater, things start going out of the way. So let us see some of the situation, what happens to the patient and what should be our response to these cases. So now, what are we going to discuss? We'll discuss about oozing wounds. Operation is done and patient has got oozing. We discuss about patient telling me he has got pain. And they say, doctor, you told me that I will have no pain after surgery, but I'm in a lot of pain. Has something gone wrong? That's the first response of a patient. Then we talk about thromboprophylaxis. That's a very sensitive topic today, because it's like if you do it, you have complication. If you don't do it, you still have complications. There is no best solution for that, but you still have to consider it and you have to take some action, because it is medically very important for most of the arthroplasty surgeons. Then we talk about physiotherapy. It's again another issue where some people or some surgeons sometimes say, oh, my knees don't require physiotherapy. And that could be their selling point. And many times patients come to us and say, doctor, will I need physiotherapy? Because that XYZ guy told me that I don't need physiotherapy after my surgery. So what should be your response to these people who have been counseled for or against physiotherapy? What should you tell them? Then we talk about what are the do's and don'ts you tell to the patient. So patient asks, doctor, main ghar mein jaane ke baad kya kar sakta hun aur kya nahi kar sakta hun? So those do's and don'ts also must be properly told to the patient. So what should you advise the patient after the surgery when they are going home from the operation? And then the very commonly asked question is, doctor, will I become completely normal? And when will I become completely normal? So you have to give them some kind of a timeline of how the things is going to proceed and when they can be, in inverted commas, completely normal. Because being normal for everybody has a different way of understanding. So let us go to the first thing, oozing wounds. Now, this is a nightmare for any arthroplasty surgeon. You have done the surgery and the knee looks like this, and you know that you will lose your sleep for the next couple of months. So you don't want this to happen. So when a patient after the surgery gets a oozing from a post-op wound, what should you do? Is it a normal oozing? Well, if at all there is something called as a normal oozing, is it due to blood thinners? Because many times we give them blood thinners like Lexin and other things, or you know, Ecosprin, etc. And many times you know that it is a well-known fact that people after starting blood thinners in arthroplasty started getting more number of patients with the so-called oozing wounds. So is it because of blood thinners, or is it because of patient is just too fat? You get a lot of fat ladies and there is a lot of fat which can get necrosis, and you may get a little bit of a oozing on second, third or fourth day. So is it just a fat necrosis, or is it a superficial skin infection? Now, this is something more serious, more risky. Or is it just a mild infection? The question is, you are faced with so many questions. Patient may ask you all these things, and then what is the answer for that? Now, what is very important is what we do. What should you do? Should you wait? Should you wait and stop blood thinners? Should you immobilize the leg or put it in a plaster of Paris cast or a slab so that it doesn't move, so it doesn't bleed, so it doesn't ooze? That's a simple logic which many people follow. Or should I continue my antibiotic? I have stopped antibiotic as per the classical training or teaching at maybe 24 hours or maybe 48 hours, depending on what you believe. And then the patient gets oozing on third and fourth day. Should I restart my antibiotic? Should I operate? Should I wash out? Should I open, give a debridement, do arthroscopic lavage? Or is it a case where I will end up requiring revision? So all these questions have to have some rational and logical answers. So if you go through the literature, a lot of things have been published about so-called oozing wounds, the so-called primary washout or debridement, etc. We do not have a lot of time because there are other topics. But in short, usually when are the dressing change? Normally when I do the surgery, the first dressing change in our clinic is after 24 hours. And usually that is the time just to have a look at the dressing to see that the wound is clean. There is no obvious major problem. The wound is normally dry beyond that. And on second, third or fourth day, the patient is discharged. But suppose there is oozing, the patient dressing is still wet at 48 hours. Then what should I do? So normally a day two oozing, we should wait. We can, if the patient has got blood thinners like Lexan, etc., I normally stop that for a couple of days, convert the patient on Ecosprin, which has got lesser risk of oozing, but medically you are still safe. We do a lot of icing to the patient. So the icing will reduce inflammation. We prevent excessive mobilization. I don't stop them. I don't give any kind of a splint or a brace, but we reduce the active forceful movement. We allow them to do active movement as much as they can comfortably do. We allow them to stand and walk to go to toilet, but prevent excessive physiotherapy. And then we wait for another 2 days. But suppose at day 4 and 5, when they are expected to go home, because you have promised them that I'll send you home in 4th day or 5th day, and the dressing is still wet, then what you should do? Now, at that point of time, when the dressing, second or maybe even third dressing by this, is still wet and is significantly wet, then you have to take a call on, is it an infection or is it a oozing because of internal hematoma? Many times, patient may have some amount of hematoma, or it may be a fat necrosis in a very obese patient, and then you may get a wet wound for some time. Now, what is just a wet wound and what is a precursor of infection? There are some other criteria which you have to follow. And these criteria basically involve, number one, is if the patient has got a redness around the incision, which is much more than what you have seen on the day one at the first post-op dressing. The wound becomes red, looks angry. If there is a more pain and more warmth around the wound than what you, when I checked it at 24 hours, at day 4 and 5, if the patient has started getting more pain, normally there is more pain on first, second day, and the pain start going down by day 4, day 5. But the reverse thing happened. The patient has got more pain on day 5 than when she on second day. Or the patient has got reduction in a movement. Like patient immediately get good movement for the first 2 days. They may go to 60, 70, 80 degrees within 48 hours. That is what normally happens in most of the patients. And then after the next 3 days, the patient, instead of 70, 80, becomes again 40, 50 or 30. So these are the ominous signs. Number one is the wound becoming red around. So you've got more inflammation. It becomes angry, warm. Patient get more pain. Patient lose range, which he has got in the first 2 days. And patient may have got some fever. These are not good signs. These signs may indicate that there could be infection and it is not just an innocuous oozing or a wet wound. So at that point of time, what we normally do is we wait and put aspiration, put a needle in the knee and from the different area, not from the incision side, but from the superolateral area where you can easily access to the joint, a wide bore needle in an operation theater in a proper aseptic precaution, aspirate the fluid, send it for culture, send it for any histological gram staining. And if you find any organism or the culture grows something positive, you get it within 48 hours, then that means there is an infection. If the culture, if you get adequate hematoma and the culture is negative, then you can still wait for the next 2, 3, 4 days. But when the oozing still continues by day 9, 10 or 11, then that's a bad thing. At this point of time, you have already stopped anticoagulation. You have given adequate amount of icing to the knee. You have reduced the amount of excessive mobilization. And till the oozing is there, then it is a time to open the wound. It is very important that at day 10 or 11, if the patient still has got oozing wound, it probably is infection unless proved otherwise. So this is time you should do a debridement, open the wound, give a thorough debridema, do deep cultures, take soft tissues, which is necrotic out, send a tissue sample for culture, not just the fluid, but the tissue sample. And if you have got a modular implant, like not a monoblock implant, but modular implant where plastic is separate, disengage the plastic, because usually between the plastic and a metal base plate, there is a lot of blood which is collected. And that is an area which is not accessible for any kind of a cleaning unless you have opened that plastic and changed the plastic. So this is called exchange of liner. So these are the three things. We must open, debride completely, send multiple cultures to, I normally send it to 2 different prominent labs and minimum 3 to 4 cultures. Because it is extremely important at this point of time to get a positive organism identified. I have seen many times that you get a culture report is negative and then you are in a big mess because you don't know exactly what you are dealing with. And many times it could be a minor organism which can create a problem. So I normally send at least 3 or 4 samples to 2 different labs. It may be a little bit of an expensive thing, but if you don't get the culture at debridement, then that patient is definitely going to go for a two-stage revision later on. He's not going to get improved. I'll tell you some of the data later on, but at day 10 to 11, oozing wound is a bad sign, whether it looks angry or whether it looks inflamed or whether it looks having patient having no fever, etc., or reasonable movement, you have to open it. Now, patient has a prolonged oozing wound hematoma, and these are the signs which are there. You have opened it. What is the chance that you will be successful after doing this aggressive way of debridement? Now, knee aspiration, culture, other parameters like CBC, ESR, CRP, all those things, tactician scan, gallium scan, all of those things are of not much of a use, because usually CBC, ESR, CRP could be high because of your recent surgery. So they don't give you any added benefit, and you cannot keep on doing them every day because they can have normal variation. Again, bone scan again is useless at such a short period of time to identify any infection. The only thing which can give you is actual aspiration, opening and deep debridement and deep culture. Now, this is a collective decision. So if it is in doubt, always be aggressive in these cases. Now, this is a very interesting article. 32% infection rate were cured when the debridement was done, if the debridement is done rapidly. And this 32% infection rate cure rate is possible only when, remember this, one out of three patient only will be cured of infection. Two out of three patients, after being aggressive, still develop a late infection and end up having a two-stage revision. And this success is only when you have got a gram-positive sensitive organism, you have got a good host resistance, that is, patient has no RA, no steroid, no diabetes, there is no discharging sinus, and your surgery is done within 4 months of primary surgery or within 2 to 4 weeks of symptoms of infection. And there are multiple literature which has proven that this is the situation. So debridement is not a panacea, and it should be done only once. So this is another article from Mayo Clinic, which has mentioned that they have collected cases of bilateral TKR done in Mayo Clinic, and bilateral infection were found. Those patients or those knees which they debrided had 90% infection recurrence. Just 1 out of 10, actually, they could cure, eradicate infection. While these patients, which were treated with two-stage revision right in the beginning, had a very good outcome in these. So oozing or a wet wound is not as innocuous as it seems in some of the cases. And the surgeon need to take a call on which are the innocuous, safe wet wounds and which are the ones where you have to be aggressive. And I'll explain you what we follow. So at day 10, day 12, when the patient is nearing the stitch removal and is still wet, please open, debride and be aggressive. So another article, superficial skin infection, most of 60% patient in this article with superficial skin infection develop into deep infection. So as I said, almost 2/3 cases of so-called SSSI eventually are deep infection, and you cannot salvage them just by debridement. Now we come to the second thing. We talk about pain management. So what makes the patient comfortable? What makes the patient have more pain? And what you should do so that the experience of a patient is such that he or she comes back to you for the second surgery? Because I have seen at least few times where post-op patient had so much pain because of certain reasons, and these patients do not came back to me for surgery for the next 3 to 4 years. They postponed the surgery. They were so scared of operation that they had to wait for 3-4 years to gather the strength and mental courage to come back for a second surgery. And many of them, I'm quite sure, may not have come back to me. They may have gone to somebody else, because they always think that something has gone wrong in the operation if you have so much pain in the surgery. So what is important to realize is pain is the most feared factor for unwilling patient. The patient do not want to undergo surgery because of the fear of pain. Now, how do we get a painless surgery? And for that, it is not just a medication. It's not just what I do to the patient after I do the surgery. It's not what medication I give, what blocks I give, what injection drugs I give to the patient. The painless surgery concept starts from before the operation. So you have to do a proper pre-op counseling of a patient. So they should expect some amount of pain. Don't tell them or don't oversell them that I am going to do surgery where pain will be gone, because there is going to be some pain in spite of whatever you do. You must do pre-op physical training. So patient must be given exercise chart to make them exercise, so they know exactly what to do. During surgery, obviously, you have to do minimal tissue dissection, and you must have a well-balanced, well-aligned knee, because that's the basis of not having pain. Now, once you are done a great surgery, and I'm quite sure you are trained very well. Most of you attended a lot of conferences, maybe some workshops, and now you are doing a good job. So you have done a well-balanced, well-aligned surgery. How does the pain can be minimized after the operation? What things can be done by a surgeon when the patient is out of theater? So what we do is we give preemptive analgesia. It's very important to realize that pain after the surgery is a surgical pain. So what happens is you cut the tissues. There's a tissue damage, tissue destruction, and these destroyed tissues create some enzymes which create some other chemicals. These are called pain mediator chemicals, that is prostaglandin, etc. And they start working on the nerve endings. Now, if you can give analgesic like anti-inflammatory to the patient before the surgery, the formation of PGE2 will be much less. If you give them cyclooxygenase inhibitor, COX-2, COX-1 inhibitor, automatically, even though you have done the tissue damage, the amount of chemicals which cause pain formation will be much less. So it is very important to give them before surgery anti-inflammatory, and we also give them a pregabalin on the previous night if they can tolerate it. You have to try that before. You can't just give on the day before, because some of them do not tolerate it very well. But pregabalin is supposed to reduce the sensitization of the spinal cord, and that has been shown to reduce the perception of pain in a patient in many cases. So these are the two preemptive analgesia, anti-inflammatory like diclofenac sodium and paracetamol, given just an hour or hour and a half before the surgery. You can give injectable, or you can give tablet in the morning, maybe a couple of hours before the operation. And a previous night, we give them pregabalin as an oral dose. Then during the surgery, we have got periarticular infiltration. All of us know about this Ranawat cocktail, who conceptualized injecting a group of drugs, which include a steroid, include a alpha blocker, include a local anesthetic, include a local anti-inflammatory agent. All these things in various combination, because various people use various things. Everybody has their own group or combination of drugs. But basically, it is a periarticular infiltration which will reduce the local effect of surgery in the patient after operation. And it normally can last for the next 18 to 24 hours, depending on what you have selected in that patient. And that is why immediate post-surgery, when the patient comes out of anesthesia, they are reasonably well off. So they are comfortable for the first 24 hours. So we always use this periarticular infiltration. Then we talk about regional blocks. Again, today, there are two ways of controlling pain and doing the surgery. One is giving regional block like femoral canal block or giving epidural infusion pump. So many times we give combination of either epidural infusion pump or a simple spinal anesthesia with a regional block. It depends on whether your anesthetist do it well. It can be done using a ultrasound, technique. So anesthetist can actually identify your peripheral vessel and femoral nerve and femoral canal and infiltrate around it. And believe me, it makes a wonderful difference to the patient's pain after the surgery for the first 24 hours, or maybe sometime it goes on till 36 hours. So if you do not have anesthetist to do it, make them do it, because it is not a very difficult thing or a rocket science, but that helps to the patient for the post-op pain. And you can immediately make the patient mobilize the same day evening, and we can make them walk very next day of surgery, almost in 8 out of 10 cases. Now, if you go give PCA, that is called patient control analgesia, we don't have that because we don't have patient control auto pumps in India. I haven't seen them very often in many hospitals. The only drawback of those things is patients sometimes can overdrug themselves, and the system, the drugs are given into the IV line. So basically these drugs can cause a systemic effect on a patient. And usually the drugs used in this PCA are the drug which can addiction or habit forming drugs. So PCA is something which we haven't used. I haven't used in India very often. We used to use that when I was in England and USA, but it is not very common in India. And well, if you have one, you can always use it. But again, it has got a relative less use because it has got a systemic effect on a patient. And then to this, we must add IV and oral post-op analgesia. What we normally give a combination of paracetamol, 1 gram, almost 4 or 6 hourly. We can give tremadol, 50 milligram, 8 hourly. And we can give diclofenac sodium or any other NSAID like etoricoxib at a full dose. Now, this is also added with oxyciprole, which is a basically drug which reduces the WBC migration and reduce the amount of inflammation around the wound. So it is not direct anti-inflammatory thing, but it reduces the leukocyte migration and then it reduces indirectly the pain. And we also give them a pregabalin in a post-op period, usually at night. So a combination of these, the paracetamol, the tramadol, they all act in a different way. I have seen many times when you have got a different anesthetist coming for your case in a bigger hospital because they have their own anesthetist. If I write all these post-op things, they say, doctor, iska kya jarurat hai? Humne already epidural diya hai. But believe me, if you give all this combination together, because these drugs act in a different way, paracetamol act in a different way than tramadol, that act in a different way than anti-inflammatory drugs like etoricoxib, and that acts in a different way than your oxyciprole and your pregabalin. So if you have, I always tell my fellows that if you have a fire in your house, and if you got 3 things to douse the fire, you have got a sand bucket, you have got a water, and you have got extinguisher pump. Now, if it is a standard fire, you should not wait for one to act, and if it doesn't act, go to the next one. We all use all of them if possible. So for pain, if you've got 5 things which work at a different level of pain cycle or a pain pathway, you must use all of them. It is not an overkill, but believe me, these are used in a controlled fashion. And for the next 3 days, 4 days, patients are very comfortable and most of them are able to walk the very next day of surgery. So add these post-op IV or oral analgesia, depending on when the patient starts taking oral medication, even though the patient has got a block, even though they may have got an epidural infusion pump, or even though you are given a periarticular infiltration, because all of them together works very well. So basically, painless surgery for a patient is not a myth. It is a coordinated efforts on the behalf of surgical team, which includes surgeon, obviously, and a physical therapist, anesthetist, and rehabilitation specialist. So basically, the physiotherapist should know that the patient should be given enough ice fomentation to reduce inflammation, aggressive exercise, mobilization for the first 24 hours, because all of that is going to work best in the first 24 hours. And patient may start getting more pain at 48 or 72 hours. So the physiotherapist must be tuned to start mobilization on the same day evening. If you've got physiotherapist coming next day evening, you have lost the bus because all the effect of periarticular infiltration is already gone. Now we come to the third thing about thromboprophylaxis. Now that is very sensitive topic. Because the issue is basically post-op, post-TKI DVT is an accepted issue. Everybody knows that it happens. Now we don't say Indian patient, we don't get DVT. And the question is, how many TKIs have DVT? It is, if you see, depending on what sensitive test you use, many of the patient may get DVT. If you use something like a radioactive fibrinogen uptake test, then almost 45 to 50% people can be shown to have a DVT over there. And then, does it mean that we have to aggressively stop the DVT? Because we still do not know that whether the DVT is always a precursor to pulmonary embolism. Because what we worry is not some DVT happening in a calf veins or a thigh veins, but what we don't want is suddenly the patient dying in your hand. And it has been shown with multiple studies that DVT occurrence and P occurrence are not always statistically correlated to each other. So preventing DVT does not necessarily mean you reduce a post-TKR mortality. And there are recent articles which have shown that post-TKR mortality does not necessarily go away, because the things like post-TKR mortality could be almost about 24% cases because of cardiac problems, sudden cardiac infarct or some cardiac event. Now these cannot be changed by DVT prevention. And we have to take a call on how aggressive I need to be on DVT prophylaxis. Can I have a risk of bleeding, oozing, hematomas? And this is where the role of aspirin comes. Now, this was a very big battle, I can say, between ACCP, that is American Chest Physician Organization, who actually initially formulated a lot of criteria for DVT prophylaxis. And almost they had given such an aggressive criteria that they have to be accepted, because many of these articles were published in the literature. And as you know that if something is published, it can be used by the patient, if they get DVT, to sue the doctor. And the problem in orthopedic surgery is that because you are dealing with bones, the bones can bleed, they can ooze. And oozing can stop only by formation of a clot on the top. You stop the clot, the bleeding can continue. We are not talking about small clot in a small vessel in a, you know, peripheral arteries. So most of the orthopedic surgeons, they realize that if you give aggressive anticoagulation, it leads to a lot of bleeding. And many people get hematoma. And if you get a hematoma in your TKR, that's the end of it, because you are going to get infection in almost 30% of those cases. So they started advocating aspirin. And in the last about 7 to 8 years, a lot of literature has been published on the aspirin. And there is a very beautiful article which has come just about 2 years ago in a JOA, and which has mentioned the role of aspirin. And they have found that aspirin is very useful, number one. I'll just tell you the conclusion of that article. Number one, aspirin is found to be useful and it has been backed by published results. So you are medically safe when you use it. Number two, it is not necessary to add an anticoagulation to that. You can just use aspirin. Number three, we don't need to give a very high dose. Initially, they used to give 350 milligram twice a day. That is almost 700 milligram per day. And they found that a lot of patients get gastritis because of that. And these are all elderly people. Some of them could have renal problem, renal issues, and a high dose aspirin was not acceptable for them. And they found in these comparative studies that even a low dose aspirin, which is as low as 75 to 150 milligram per day, is adequate to give effective antiplatelet activity so that the DVT can be reduced significantly. So we don't have to give high dose. And added benefit of aspirin is that this aspirin, because it is antiplatelet, also have been shown to reduce the cardiac event after the post-surgery. So they have found that the sudden death, which may happen in about 0.5 to 1% patients after TKR, can reduce by almost about 40 to 50%. So that's the added benefit which aspirin has, while LMWH do not have that. So aspirin definitely is now acceptable. There are enough published data about aspirin in literature and AOS. And now, to be the funny part is, even ACCP has accepted that aspirin has a role in preventing the DVT. So we can use it, and we always use aspirin. We very rarely use LMWH in a big way. We may use if patient has a high risk, or the patient has got some other reason when we believe that there is a higher risk of DVT, then we use LMWH. But usually we stick to ecosprin or aspirin, 75 or 150 milligram, and we continue that for about 4 to 6 weeks post-surgery, because they have shown that the DVT can happen up to 4 to 6 weeks, and aspirin given up to 3 to 4 weeks are usually effective. So that's regarding the post-surgery DVT prophylaxis. We are now focusing more on aspirin. And LMWH is restricted to only few patients where you think it is a higher risk. Now, then a question comes to you that, doctor, will I need physiotherapy? And as I mentioned before, that the patient has been many times, canvassed by some of the surgeons or a hospital that, okay, I do some surgery so great that you don't need physiotherapy. And that's not entirely right, because physiotherapy is not just getting the patient doing some exercises. Basically, physiotherapists tell the patient to how to stand, how to walk, how to stair climbing. All these activities are important in most of the elderly people. If a patient is on the younger side, 40, 45, 50, 55, then they can do this without a problem. But if you are dealing a lady of say 70, 75 and or an elderly person of that age, then these people have some amount of inherent imbalance. They may have got some neurological condition. They may just have got old age, weakness, and they need some supervised exercise therapy so that they know exactly how to use a walker, how to do stair climbing, how to prevent fall after the surgery, And somebody has to assess the amount of quadricep power they have. So somebody has to decide, should they continue using a knee brace? Because the commonest rule is, if a patient can do active SLR without any sag, they don't need any knee brace. They can walk without a knee brace. And in some people, it may happen as soon as 4 or 5 days after surgery. Or in some people, it may take maybe 3 or 4 weeks. So somebody has to assess that in home. And the patient has to be counseled accordingly so that they use the knee brace for long enough time so that they don't buckle while walking. So you cannot leave the patient on their own. So if you ask me, will you need physiotherapy? Normally, I answer the patient, 30-40%, if they are young, they may not require a special physiotherapy at home. But if you are elderly, if you are not progressing as well as I expect, it is wiser to get somebody to help you out in the first couple of weeks or maybe 3-4 weeks. And they normally accept it. Now, what should you tell the physiotherapist after the surgery? Now, as I said, the most important part of getting an excellent outcome, no doubt it is a surgical technique which you have done, maybe the implant which you have used, but very important is you have to be aggressive in mobilization. The patient has to start movement the same day evening. You must see the patient and make them move, bend the knee, because the least pain is on the same day evening because of effect of periarticular infiltration, effect of block, and effect of other medication. Then by the next day morning, the patient must start standing full weight bearing and must be able to walk completely full weight bearing with the help of walker. If you miss this 24 hours, then whatever you have done for pain control will have no effect from the second day. So if you can manage this, most of your patient, 80%, 85% of them will be walking comfortably on a second day morning and they will be easily able to go home on the third day. That is our normal protocol. Now, how long physiotherapy is required? As I said, you assess the patient on the third day or a fourth day when they go home. If you feel they are unstable, if you feel they do not have adequate quadricep extension, then you tell them to get some physiotherapists who can assess them at home and assess them how long they have to use the knee brace or a knee splint. And if they don't get this guidance properly, some of them may develop a fall, may have some complication. Now the question is, they ask, doctor, what are the do's and don'ts at home after the surgery? You have done a great job. They have started walking. They are moving around second day, third day, and a third or fourth day they are going home. So they want to know, and especially relatives want to know, because many of them are all internet savvy. They have gone on the net and they have found multiple websites of what wonderful things patient can do on second, third day. And they want the same wonderful thing done by their mothers or fathers who could even be 70 or 80 year old. So they will ask me, what should they do? What should they not do at home? So normally, what are the do's? One important thing is patient must do enough amount of icing of knee. Ice application is probably one of the best way to reduce pain in an inflamed post-surgery knee joint. Then you must tell them not to try to save pain medicine. Now, this is another thing. A lot of patients I have found that they say, doctor, I don't want pain medicine. That is fine. But they don't do exercises because they get pain. So on one hand, if they try to save it, and I have to be blunt to tell them that don't try to save it, don't use your head or brain to see what you need. Just take it for the next 4 or 5 days, what we prescribe, unless there is a problem or a complication, then you get back to us. Because many times, if they don't have good pain relief, once they go home on the third, fourth day, because that is the time all what you have done in the hospital will start wearing out. These are the people, because of pain, will not exercise more, and suddenly you'll find that when they come at day 12 or day 14 for stitch removal, the patient who has gone home with 90 degree range would come back with 30 degree range. And then that 30 degree will never go back to 110, 120, because these people in the last 6, 7, 8 days at home have tried to save pain medication because somebody tells them, "Kare usse kidney kharab ho jati hai, aap mat le lo," and they listen to that. And then they end up, because they may end up getting a chronic pain because of lack of movement, lack of exercises, lack of activity. So the biggest do not is tell them not to stay on pain medicines. Please take whatever you have prescribed, because you are prescribing them quite well. You have considered their kidney function and other activities, and accordingly they are giving them medication, because tried those things in a hospital for 2 days. Then they must exercise 3 to 4 times on their own, not just follow the physiotherapy instruction once a day. That is extremely important to be regular. They should be regular Only walking, use night splints if it is required, use TED stockings, and use walking aids whenever it's required. So basically, all these things are essential. You have to make the patient realize that these things make a big difference between an excellent outcome and an average outcome. It's not just the surgeon, but if the patient also decide whether he will be the top 10 percentile or he'll be an averagely good patient. There are not too many don'ts apart from what I mentioned, Kumar. But it's very important that when the patient goes home, I normally have at least 10 to 15 minutes talk with the patient. So I usually see them on the day of the discharge, talk to them about all these things, and make sure that one relative who is with the patient at home is there for this counseling. Because they are the one who sometimes prevent the patient from doing a lot of things because they have read something in the internet. So these are the things which the patient must take home as a message from you on the day of discharge. And last thing, when will I be completely normal? That's a question asked many people. They want to know exactly when they will be completely normal. Now, what we have to realize is the completely normal label is very variable. For a person who may be, say, 50, 55, who is doing a job, for them, it means going back to the work and office. That may mean they have to travel by bus or train and in a crowded places. And that may take maybe 6 weeks, maybe 8 weeks, depending on their physical fitness and ability to exercise. Or for somebody who is just having a desk job, it may just mean going to the office by car and sitting for 2-3 hours. So we have to analyze what they want, what they expect, and then accordingly give them a functional timeline. Don't always commit the patient. Because I remember once one of the surgeon has told the patient, "Arey kuch nahi hoga, aap ekdam bahut acche chaloge, bhagoge, daudoge." Now that's a way of saying. And this patient had once came to see me after about 4 months. She took a second opinion only because she said, "Doctor, my primary doctor told me ki main daudne wali hu, lekin abhi 4 mahine ho gaye main daud nahi rahi hu." Now this was a 72-year-old lady. Now sometimes they take your advice quite literally, so you have to be very careful when you tell them what you tell, what you know, what words which you use. So it is very important to tell the patient not a very definite functional timeline ki kabhi kya hoga, kitne din lagenge. You have to tell them that it depends on how much exercises you are going to put in. On an average, 6 to 8 weeks. But in your case, if you do more exercises, it could be 3 weeks or it could be 3 months. So you have to be very guarded. So usually the timeline, the functional goal which we have in our clinic, LAAD clinic, is number one, there is no fixed timeline. We tell the patient that you will be comfortable. Usually day one, they are able to do all the movement, sitting up, knee bending. Next day morning, they start walking with the walker, full weight bearing. And by third day or maybe fourth day, they are able to do even the stair climbing. So that's the normal timeline, but you must make sure that the patient realizes that it is a individualized goal. Everybody cannot be same. So basically, these are the things which patient will ask you, and the other thing which you may have to look after the patient when you have done the TKR surgery and you are hoping that the patient gets well and become happy, and then not only come back to you for the second side, but bring their friends and their relatives back to you. So that's very important, as important as the actual surgeries. So thank you very much. Maybe there could be some questions. If you have some questions, you can ask them.
Yes, sir. Thank you for a very lucid talk. So just a few points. There is some debate that goes on about selective COX-2 inhibitors and their safety profile, especially in patients who are high risk with cardiac histories. And there are papers that are coming out with selective COX-2 inhibitors causing sudden cardiac deaths. So what would be your choice and your take on use of the same?
If a patient has a normal cardiac history, there is no history of previous IHD, and all the patients which undergo surgery with us, we get their dobutamine stress test done, because I think it is essential. A lot of the time, surgeons are happy with just ECG and 2D echo, saying ECG 2D echo normal, so why do you need DST? Because not every cardiologist is going to do DST. And it means a little bit of a cost for the patient. They may have to go to some particular hospital to get it done. But the most important part we have to realize is that many times these are elderly people. They have not walked for a long distance. So for them, undergoing a surgery is like making them run a 100-meter race. The resting ECG and a resting 2D echo may be normal, But under the stress, would the heart behave normal or would the heart behave some kind of an irregularity? Many times they get a missed beat, they get a ectopics when the heart rate goes up. And that could be possible only after doing a dobutamine stress test or some stress test. So we have done this patient and we make sure that the DST is done. So if the DST is normal, 2D echo is normal, ECG is normal, patient has reasonable activity of pre-surgery, then I do not have any problem about giving them any anti-inflammatory COX-2 inhibitors or just a diclofenac sodium for the first 3-4 days. Because the pain, inflammatory pain is maximum in the first 2-3 days. If you are worried about it, maybe from third or fourth day when they go home, just give them paracetamol and tramadol combination and maybe oxyciprol and maybe pregabalin at night. And that is usually good enough. But anti-inflammatory makes a wonderful improvement. And people, only people we don't give them are the people with the renal problem. If the creatinine is high, then I am a little reluctant to give them any NSAIDs.
Right, sir. Sir, unilaterals, bilateral simultaneous, what is your take? DST for all patients? Or do you still do
simultaneous? I do DST for all patients. Yeah, I do DST for all patients. See, there is no reason why a 75-year-old person who has got severe arthritis in the knee, who has not walked more than household ambulation, would be fit. It could be something occult in a heart which may not have been seen. And that could be visible only under the stressful condition when heart rate goes up to maybe 120, 130, 140. And that you will not know by resting ECG or resting 2D echo. It may be quite normal. So that is very important. Now, whether I do bilateral or unilateral depends on many factors. Number one is patient has to be below 65. Number two, the patient should not have any comorbidities like diabetes and hypertension. Then patient should not be obese. Patient should not have severe deformity. And patient should have adequate surgery activity level.
Activity.
If a patient is more or less housebound, our patient has not walked much, then that's not a good idea to do bilateral because you are pushing the patient beyond the limit. So right. In my practice, about 10 to 15% patients are bilateral, 85% right. Patients are unilateral.
Right. Sir, then if we come to use of the newer anticoagulants, that is NOACs, selective 10A inhibitors, direct thrombin inhibitors, what is your take on the same? So there are different guidelines of high risk parameters for DVT as far as the risk goes. That is obesity, comorbidities, earlier surgeries, etc. So when would you choose to use only aspirin, or would you do that for all patients? Or if you have a morbidly obese BMI more than 30 patient who is moribund, would you change your protocol to T prophylaxis to use a selective 10A inhibitor?
Yeah, this is a very good question and a very individual question because the literature, I have a couple of times in one of the national meeting talked about the DVT prophylaxis and done a literature review at that point of time. And I did read some recent literature now for this talk. The average understanding is that if a patient has a high risk for DVT, and there are certain guidelines of what is high risk, then definitely you have to use some amount of some LMWH, whether IV, injectable or oral is immaterial. It is found that injectable is usually better than oral because oral has been shown to have more risk of bleeding on an average. And third thing is in those patients, when they have got a high risk, I explained to the patient that this is what is a high risk. This can happen. And in spite of giving also DVT prophylaxis, the patient may still get DVT and can have sudden issues. So I normally involve my cardiologist and I ask them to decide what they should be, what we should be used and how long. Because if they get DVT or other problem, they are the cardiologists are going to treat them. The patient is quite well warned that, look, this can be mean that there could be oozing wound, there could be, you know, hematoma, there could be second surgery required, and all those things are there. So it is very important to be transparent to the patient, explain them everything, and we normally note it down in our notes that this has been explained to the patient, talk to the patient. It's very important you note it down on a patient. See, ultimately, you'll always find a cases where patient may be high risk and nothing has happened and you may not have done anything. Or on the other hand, patient may have nothing, but suddenly you will get a problem. And it has been shown that there could be sudden death is almost about 0.1%. And these are the patients where you just don't know what happened. They just die. And I have got 3 to 4 experiences like this in my last 20 years of practice. And I still remember each one of the patients because it's a big shock to the surgeon. When they come, they are doing very well for the first 2 or 3 days and something goes wrong and they are no more. So it's a very shocking and disturbing experience. But some of them, I think, just you can't avoid. As far as you are transparent with the patient and explain them everything and noted it down. So our consent also include all those things, including the risk of death. We have special consent made at Lard Clinic for TKR, for THR, and for trauma. Then each of them, we have given all the complications, including risk of death and a percentage of each of them. So it is important in today's world that these are difficult situations. There is no hard and fast final rule or nobody can guide you. It is a call which you have to take. And basically, whatever you may do, you should be medically prepared for that.
Sir, I just wanted to say, sir, specifically the consent, I completely agree, sir, this hospital consents that we normally use, because when we come out of post-graduation, we normally use just hospital consents, your consent for surgery and that's it. But it's definitely not enough for an arthroplasty.
No. We have made a special consent for TKR, special consent for THR, and a special consent for a trauma case. Because the complications are different. THR is dislocation, many other things. That is not there in TKR.
Yes.
So trauma, there is something different. It could be pathological fracture, something else. So these are our consent. Even if I go to any big hospital like Rishikandi and Hinduja, they may sign a consent, but they have to sign my consent. We give the consent on the previous day when they get admitted, and my fellows then collect the consent next day morning. So we give them the consent. It's a 2-page consent for each of it, front and back. You tell them, you read this, keep it with you today, and tomorrow sign and give it to us before surgery. So they have enough time, because it's very important. Because, see, medically, if you have seen some of the articles and some of the reviews, usually patient on the way to surgery theater given something and asked to sign. And then patient can easily claim, ki, I didn't know what I signed. I signed some 20 things and one of them was a consent. So if you have given it to him a previous night and collected next day morning, there is no question. And one more thing which what we do is we make them write, because see, this consent is in English, right? I can't make a consent in multiple language, because being in Bombay, I get patients who are Tamil and Malayali and, you know, Kannada and Gujarati and Marathi and Hindi. So we can't make 25 languages. So we make an English consent, and the bottom line is a sentence I have to make them write in their own language. If they are Tamil or they're say Gujarati, they write that I have read it and I understood it. Like in Marathi, they have to write me vasala ahe ani mala kalu ahe. When they write that one sentence in their own language and sign, then they cannot say later on ki mujhe samjha nahi tha kuske upar sign liya, because you are written in your own language. So these are 2 things. One is you must carry your own consent, and we keep the consent ourselves. So if a patient is in Hinduja, they sign their own consent, they keep in their document, but I have a book of consent kept with me for all my patients. Because ultimately, the onus is on you. Something goes wrong, you will be responsible, maybe more than the hospital, and hospital will not release that consent to you.
Sir, I'm even including use of their x-rays and photographs for publication. So we use a lot of their x-rays and patient videos sometimes.
Line you can add, that your operation record without releasing the information or the name or individuality may be used, that you can add in the bottom. Yes, that's not very important. That you can add in the bottom, that this may be used for a teaching purpose or a publication without releasing the identity of the patient. That you can add at the bottom. That is not an important thing. It is there if you are in a habit of publishing things. That is also there in the bottom of our consent.
Yes,
sir. Sir, when you see a patient in the clinic before surgery, many a times a common question that the patient asks is, after surgery, can I sit on the floor? Can I kneel?
Yeah.
Yes. What are your answers to that?
See, normally, it is my own experience that we use rotating platform high flexion designs, because I personally believe that if you need to have high flexion, you must have a rotating platform design, because patient use high flexion for sitting cross-legged. That means you are twisting the tibia completely to sit and cross the leg. That means there has to be rotational freedom between femur and tibia, which is allowed more than what a box and a cam or, you know, the tibiofemoral mechanism allow. So if the free rotation is there, they can get better range. This is my perception. This is my experience. And in my practice, about 35 to 40% patient can easily sit on the floor with both legs crossed. And about another 30% people can sit with one leg crossed, one leg little stretched out. So I tell them that both leg crossing, there is a 35-40% chance you'll sit on the floor. One leg cross, one leg straight, another 35%. And 30% patient, you will not be able to sit on the floor cross-legged. Now, which one of you will be in which group, I don't know. It is up to you. It is up to your flexibility, your exercises. If you exercise and make them flexible, the joint can bend to 150, because most of these high flexion joints are on paper supposed to bend up to 130, 140, 150. So if you explain them that you get a joint, and you know, it's a simple thing. I tell them that, look, I can give you a bat of Sachin Tendulkar, which he has made 100 centuries. But with that bat on a cricket field, will you make a century? How many runs you score depends on you. It's not a bat or a car. So they usually understand similar example like this. So tell them that the onus is on them, not on me. So never promise them you'll be able to sit down on the floor. Because like one of the surgeons say, promised ki aap bhagege, daudoge. And the lady really came back for a second opinion to me asking, ki doctor, this surgeon told me I will run, but 4.5 mahine ho gaye, bhag nahi rahi hu main. So that is, you know, they sometimes take you literally. So you have to be careful about what you talk to the patient.
Right. Should we start with the cases?
Yes. Yes, Dr. Nadir is going to present his case first, I guess. Dr. Nadir Shah?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you start sharing your screen?
Yes, sir. So I am visible, everybody and audible?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. Very good evening. Myself, Dr. Nadir Shah. I'm attached to Grand Medical College as Associate Professor. Also attached to Prince Ali Khan as a visiting consultant. Very thankful to Ortho TV, Dr. Anup sir, and Neeraj Bijlani sir for this special opportunity. And really very glad to share the same screen or the same podium with such a great stalwart, Vinde sir. So my topic today is for a case of infected total knee replacement management. There are some few different aspects to this case because of which I am presenting this case today. So here is a case of a 73-year-old female operated for a total knee replacement outside elsewhere. Patient was walking and asymptomatic for 2 months post-surgery. After 2 months, she developed pain and swelling in the left knee, which was associated with difficulty in walking. Joint aspiration was done and which revealed MRSA sensitive to linezolid, teicoplanin and clindamycin. CRP was high 176, HB was low around 8.6 gram and WBC was high around 17,000. Patient was then taken up for surgery. This was also happened outside. The tibial component was removed. The femoral component was retained. Implantation of the cement spacer was done and patient was advised a revision TKR after completing the antibiotic. Patient then came to us at JJ Hospital for the first time. Patient presented with difficulty and inability to walk. There was a discharging sinus and very severe stiffness. The blood parameters were hemoglobin around 10, WBC 17,000, CRP 1.2 and raised ESR 52. This is the x-rays by which the patient presented to us and with an intact femoral component. We intervened and took the patient for surgery. The loosened femoral component was then removed. A thorough debridement was done for the patient. Vancomycin, dobramycin and improvement spacer was placed. Intraop sample will send for culture sensitivity, where no organism were isolated. HPE showed no specific inflammation. Culture sensitivity accounts for around 7 to 11% of the cases, negative infection. So this is the immediate post-op after removing the femoral component and putting in a cement spacer. Once the infection was resolved, total knee replacement revision was planned. Lab investigation were again done before the surgery, which had controlled levels of ESR by 6, CRP was negative, and the WBC counts were 9,000. Revision TKR was planned and done. Synthetic calcium sulfate pellet impregnated with erythromycin and colistin were also used. Link hinge knee was used as the collateral were damaged and were not salvageable. This is an immediate post-op X-ray of the revision TKR, showing good component alignment of both the femur and the tibia. This is a follow-up of the patient after 6 months. And this is again a follow-up after a year. There's a very, very good paper in JOA in 2018 by Parvesi, which the result says that two positive cultures or the presence of a sinus tract were considered major criteria and diagnostic of periprosthetic joint infection. The calculated weights of elevated serum CRP should be more than 1 milligram per deciliter, D-dimer more than 860, and erythroid sediment ESR more than 30 were given 2, 2, and 1 points respectively. So there is a chart which is a major criteria, which shows two positive culture of the organism and sinus tract evident, which is infected. Minor criteria were divided into preoperative diagnosis and intraoperative diagnosis. The minor criteria included serum levels of elevated CRP, elevated ESR, which were the score of 2 and 1. Synovial fluid, elevated WBC count, positive alpha defsin, elevated synovial PM, and elevated synovial CRP were all calculated, and the score above 6 was termed as infection, whereas 2 to 5 is possibly infected. Less than 1 is definitely not infected. There is intraoperative calculations also, which included preoperative score, positive histology, positive purulence, and single positive culture. Again, the score were decided in terms of more than 6 was evident of infection. 4 to 5 is inconclusive, and less than 3 is definitely non-infective. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nadir. Okay, so what is your take on DARE? It is about debridement, antibiotics, and implant retention.
Yeah, so, why I chose this case, so there are two things what I would really like to highlight over here. Number one is if this case, when you started, there was an intact femur component. So, which is really not explainable, like when the revision surgery was done, why the surgeon had not taken out the femoral component when they have removed the tibial component. So, I feel that when you take out, you have to take out everything. If you don't take out everything, then you are leaving the infection inside. It's no point leaving a host of infection inside. And secondly, the Journal of Arthroplasty, that paper by Parvesi, it has a very, very good criteria, so which can easily, we can come up and conclude whether we can go for a revision surgery or we can still give a antibiotic coverage or wait for some time.
Yeah, so Dr. Nadir, whatever you've done is perfect. I mean, MSIS criteria are very well defined. So the question is, Dr. Bhinde, sir, when would you attempt a DARE? The patient is, the clinical profile is, patient is not having a discharging sinus. He's having an aspirate, which is, plus two minor criteria. Pain is persistent. He has some discomfort while walking. And now he comes in post-op 3 to 4 weeks after surgery. 4 weeks.
See, so debridement and debridement and retaining component is many times wishful thinking of a surgeon. Basically, because it is your baby, and you do not want to harm the baby. So when you do operation and the patient has a problem and then patient come back to you and it's difficult for you to accept. The best thing what I tell most of my fellows is, many of them are now working in a group, like 2-3 people working together, that if it is your baby, let somebody else assess it, because you are going to be a little protective about that joint. Somebody else assess that, then he will realize any infection which is in a body or a joint more than 2 weeks will not remain infection as a synovial infection or a soft tissue infection. It's going to affect the bone and it's going to cause some amount of osteomyelitis at a junction of implant and a bone. And when the infection from a synovial stage goes to the osteomyelitis at a microscopic level, any amount of debridement will not cure it. So there are enough literature showing that just 30% cases are actually salvaged. That is also only if they have got gram-positive multisensitive infection with no comorbidities, no diabetes, no RA, patient has got good health, and you know, done within say 2 weeks or 3 weeks. So there are too many ifs and buts. If somebody has got infection and come to you at 4 weeks, you have lost the bus. I don't think you should try to salvage, because you're just going to increase the misery of a patient. That patient will undergo one big surgery. That surgery will cause a lot of scarring because they will be given a lot of antibiotic, and a sensitive infection will end up going into a partially or completely resistant one. So technically, you have to bite the bullet, tell the patient that this doesn't look good to me, and you need a two-stage revision. So this retaining of implant, again, is a very risky thing, because most of the infection create a small amount of, you know, layer on the implant, which can not be technically removed, however you wash or clean it up. And these layers on the implant, biological layers on the implant, which will prevent the antibiotic to reach. So a retained metal implant in an infected joint is an absolutely bad idea. You have to get ruthlessly everything out and then debride it. Make sure that you have got enough amount of gap with a clear bleeding normal bone, then fill it up with the antibiotic cement and then do it in two stage. So this case highlights exactly what should not be done in the first surgery, when they said femur left and then antibiotic, etc. And second thing is, once you give antibiotic for 6 weeks, many times surgeon jump for revision immediately. Then you give 6 week antibiotic and a 7th week you do the surgery. It is equally important to give an antibiotic free period of minimum 6 weeks, maybe more, to make sure that stopping antibiotic will not cause the ESR, CRP to go rising again. Because you may have just suppressed the infection, may not have eliminated it, and then you will get more infection when you do replacement surgery. And revision, infected revision is really bad news for a patient, because some of them may end up having amputation.
Sir, your choice of implants for no growth, the typical scenario in Indian situation where every antibiotic has been tried, there's still no growth. What would be your choice for 6 weeks of antibiotics once the patient is on a spacer?
No growth, I'm a little worried about operating on them. Sometime a patient has come from outside and they have shown me a report of no growth. That no growth has no meaning. Like many times you take a sample, it is collected in the morning, then given to patient's hand. The relative drops it to the pathology lab that the evening because they are worried about surgery, and the culture is the next day morning. The sample may not be corrected properly, or it may not be cultured properly. The lab may not have adequate infrastructure. So it is important that in these cases, when I get a no growth and I have to do revision at the second stage, I many times tell the patient, I will not do second stage in this. I will go ahead and do remove all the sample, do it, you know, take a reculture, send it to my labs. And if that comes negative, then within 6 weeks, I'll operate on. So I've done many times a three-stage revision, especially when a first stage is not done by us. Because you cannot blame then somebody else for an infection in your revision.
Sir, if you have done an aspiration and the culture is negative, what do you do next? Do you keep the culture for 14 days?
Aspiration from where? After first stage?
No, sir.
So this is when the patient presents.
TKR comes to you and you're suspecting infection. You do an aspiration.
Yeah.
But the culture comes negative, but the patient's symptoms are highly suspicious of an infection, would you keep the culture for 2 weeks to see whether there is some very odd microorganism that's growing, or would you bite the bullet and straight away go in because the patient's symptoms probably suggest that this is, you know, more than, you know, that you're probably infected?
It's a very good question, because many times if the aspiration is negative, or grow that particular organism. And as I told you, I normally collect adequate sample and I send two samples to two different labs. And if all four of them are negative, the chances of that being positive is much less, but still not zero. Now, clinically, if the patient after aspiration coming negative from two lab with two culture each is showing positive symptom like pain, swelling, continuation of oozing at day 12, day 14, then by 2 weeks, I have to open and I have to debride. I don't lose anything by not debriding it. I just have to debride, remove everything, remove that spacer, clean up the space of the implant, put a new spacer, insert, the liner, and then send multiple culture again from the deeper tissue. It's a tissue culture. So they can use tissue culture for a different this thing. That usually works better than waiting, because it's like a surgical thing. In an acute abdomen, when it comes to you in a surgical field, you have to open it. You cannot keep on cooking it. Unless you are doing, we were told in surgery, I did general surgery before orthopedic, and we were told that unless you have got at least 25 to 30% of negative exploration in an acute abdomen, you are not doing adequate operations.
So your take on sonication of implants, is this the perfect situation to go ahead and do a sonication of explanted prosthesis?
Yeah, if you have removed the implant and if you have got ability to sonicate it and then get the culture, because sonication just improve the culture yield.
Culture quality.
So if the system or the lab which gives you, where you send up implant or the samples, they can do sonication of the implant, nothing like it. But not everywhere in India it is possible, you know, maybe big hospitals, big labs will be doing sonication. So you can always send the implant for sonication and getting, because yield will be more, the chances of negative culture will be much less, and you will always be in a better position to treat with a specific antibiotic rather than bombarding them with a, you know, blunt broad spectrum antibiotic combination.
The take on single stage divisions as they advocate at endoclinic?
It's a very good question, you know. Have you been to endoclinic?
Yes, sir, recently in 2019, I'd been there.
Yeah.
But have you been to other stage for that?
Yeah. Have you been to our hospitals? Have you seen the physical status of a German patient and an average Indian lady which comes to you?
Right.
Do you find they are simple biological specimens, single identical specimen?
No. Not at all.
I remember a patient, he was an Irish priest. He was a quite tall, 6.5 feet tall, 82-year-old gentleman. He was a priest working in one of the Bandra chapel. So he had to do knee replacement. So he came to me and I did a knee replacement in one of the hospital, not in a clinic. And 5 days, he was very good. But he was given some medicine and 6 days started getting pain in the abdomen. That was one of the Friday evening. So I told him, take antacids, etc., etc. Saturday morning, he was quite not very okay. And by Sunday morning, the abdomen was distended. So then we took an x-ray. We called the general surgeon. He took an x-ray, said there's a gas in the diaphragm. Then we diagnosed that there is probably some perforation, maybe because of the NSAID application, analgesics. That day, unfortunately, there was no surgeon available in our hospital. So I had to send it to one of the hospital in Bandra, where a general surgeon agreed to do the surgery. And I attended the operation. Then they opened the abdomen. It was all full of fecal mass. A lot of feces. The whole theater was stinking badly, like from, you know, any public toilet. And so much amount of fecal mass came out. I thought this guy is goner. I mean, but he survived. He improved from that. Then I thought this because of freshly operated knee about 4 or 5 days ago. There'll be hematoma around. So there's so much circulating in an infection, the knee will be gone. It never happened. He completely became normal. There was no problem in his knee healing. He was back to as if nothing had happened within a matter of maybe 20, 25 days. So when he came for 6-week follow-up to me, he was like any other patient. Such an amazing amount of physical strength and physical, you know, immunity or whatever you can say they have. So in that kind of a patient, one stage, plus the amount of surgery they do. Have you seen the amount of debridement they do?
Yes,
they are ruthless about removing everything, including the ligaments. They cut everything. And 8 out of 10 times, they are going to use after one stage, a link implant or whatever.
A hinge
implant. Always do it.
Very low tolerance. Because see, it's very simple. If you are willing to use hinge implant immediately, and if you are going to do everything, removing everything, cut much more than what you're going to do, then the chance of eradication of infection with the first debridement is very high. Unfortunately, we do not realize those issues, the type of a patient, the immunity of a patient, the resistance of a patient, the amount of surgical debridement they are willing to do, and amount of replacement or hinge, etc., they can be willing to accept. Plus the lab facilities they have. You cannot compare those labs with the labs which is available with one of our guys maybe living in, you know, periphery of Bombay or, you know, some outside. So those things matter a lot. We cannot just take it from them, go there for, you know, some time and start doing one stage here. I am very afraid of doing one stage even in a bigger hospital in Bombay, because the simple thing is, if that fails, then revising a infected revision implant is a horrendous job. There they won't mind, because the patient doesn't have to pay anything. They come back, they just open, remove further bigger bone and replace everything again. So you should not, you know, just pick up things from outside and put it in other environment and say, oh, because they are doing it, let me do it and let me try it. We'll be doing it at the expense of our own patients. So I haven't done a single one-stage infection revision, although theoretically we can do.
Good. Does it answer your question? Yeah. Dr. Umesh?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you can go next for want of time. Dr. Nadir, you can stop sharing your screen and Dr. Umesh can go on.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, yes.
So I'm going to present complex primary. So 55-year-old female came to OPD carried by her sons. She was bedridden for almost 6 months, not able to walk or stand without support, and had severe pain in right knee compared to left, had no comorbidities. These were her x-rays, the AP view, showing severe destruction on the medial aspect of the tibia on the right side, and the lateral view showing the large posteromedial defect. And this is how she was walking. With support, if you made her stand, she was able to walk, but she had to put in a lot of effort to walk, which she used to avoid when she was at home, so she was bedridden. So her problem was a large uncontained posteromedial defect, tight MCL, osteoporosis because she has not been walking much or not using, and also some muscular atrophy. That major problem was, my worry was how to manage the posteromedial defect. What I did was a bone graft after the cut, bone graft and 2 screws. And then added a stem to this. This was on the right side. This is after 6 weeks she was walking and she came for follow up. So management of bone defects is that can be done by cementing the bone defects for the defect which is less than 1 centimeter and well circumcised within the lesion with intact peripheral rim, so that implant sits on the rim. If defect is more than 1 centimeter, you can use a screw for reinforcement for the cement. The other way to manage this defect is using the bone graft. The bone graft that we cut from the cuts can be used for the fixation. Fixation can be done with the pins and the screws. The thing we should avoid is intrusion of the cement between the host and graft interface, which is really difficult. And the complication with graft, using bone graft, is non-union at the host and graft interface, loosening with radial lucent line or migration of prosthesis, or there can be infection. Other things that we can use is wedges, which gives more stability than bone and cement, but are costly, and stems. So my question was, using only bone cement, whether we use only bone cement after the cut if the defect is small, or do we use stem always in these cases? And if we increase the constraint with using the stem, what are the chances of that knee failing early compared to a routine primary?
Yeah, Vindy sir, your take.
Okay, can you ask the question again? Because there are certain things which you ask, I need to clarify. Ask your question again.
Yeah, so my question is, should we use only the screws and cement, or bone graft and cement, and not add the stem? Or okay, adding the stem, which adds more constraint to the care, will it wear out faster, or whether it fail faster compared to the normal?
Okay, now two things. Number one is, if you have a defect in the upper tibia, and the defect area is outside the footprint of your stem and a flange. See, usually there is a stem and there are flanges, either right, horizontal or V-shaped, depending on implant.
Right.
If the defect is outside that flange and the central stem, then usually your implant is stable, because of if you cement that stem and a flange together. Defect is encroaching on a part of a flange footprint, then the flange is not going to be stable there, in which case you may have to use a long stem. Now, the question is, would you like to use a long stem which is non-cemented? Then it has to go down all the way till the isthmus so that it can engage. You cannot use a smaller long stem which is actually dangling in the metaphyseal area.
Right.
Other option is use a smaller stem which is totally cemented. So you are now depending on the cemented portion of a stem. So, in nutshell, if the defect encroaches on the footprint of your flange and a stem, then you need additional elongation of a stem for a better fixation. If you don't do that, then if the cement gets cracked or a cement develops radiolucency, the whole implant will fail. And the simple thing is, what I normally do is, you have taken the cuts, you have put the trial stem on the edge of a stem, say on the medial side there is a defect, the edge of a medial stem, the trial, you put a force, push it with the finger, and if that implant starts tilting a bit, that's not a good idea. Then you need a stem. Filling up the cement will not work, because that cement will eventually crack or develop radiolucency and become weak, and the whole implant will fail. Right? That's question number one. So number two,
you will tap on the posterior medial part of it, or only the
wherever the defect is.
Where the defect is.
The maximum defect area, the periphery of that implant is sitting on that defect, you push it little down, the trial stem, and if the stem start, implants are toggling, means it is not a stable thing. Then you need a stem.
Right.
Number two, you talked about this length of a stem causing constraint. Now, there are two things. There is a constraint of an implant, which is decided by how much deep the box and cam is. The stem doesn't increase the constraint. The stem increases the fixation of an implant to the bone. So you probably have used a primary liner and a primary femur.
Yes.
So it was not a constrained one.
Okay.
So using a stem doesn't add to constraint. It can still open up if the balancing of ligament is not good. But if you have used a constraint, that is a deeper box and a taller cam,
right,
which then can cause more load on your implant, and this constraint will eventually load implant more and cause stress on a bone implant junction. And in that scenario, if you use a constrained implant like a TC3 or LCCK or similar one in other systems, then you will have to elongate the stem so that the fixation of implanted bone is bigger. It's not other way around. So stem doesn't increase constraint. Stem increase fixation of an implant to the bone, period.
Okay. Right. So a specific question. Use of tibial stems or extension rods are pretty much defined now. The question is, when will you choose to cement or fix in a stem for the femoral component? Because now we are jumping from the primary to a revision system for most of the implants that we use. So, for example, if we have a scenario in which we open up and we feel there is a cyst which is formed and there's a contained defect on the femur as well as the tibial side, which conditions except osteoporosis, rheumatoid, will you actually use a stem on the femoral side in your hands?
Two conditions. Number one, in a primary scenario, if I found a bone is very osteoporotic, like in some of the RA patients, and when I take the cut, I can see that the bone is very soft, then my surface cementing may not hold because that bone may crack under the load and then the whole implant will fail. So if a very osteoporotic patient is there in some of the RA patients, then I would add a small stem which is cemented and the cement the entire small stem along with the periphery of the implant and the box.
Right.
So that's the primary situation where I may use a stem because of osteoporotic bone not allowing adequate strength of a bone cement junction. In a revision scenario, when the condyle is gone and I have to use a distal condylar augment, when a condyle is gone, I use a distal condylar augment, automatically my box which is there has become shallower. And that shallower box is not going to allow me a proper rotational or mediolateral stability. So if I use any distal augment, I have to use a stem. Whether to use a long non-cemented stem or use a small cemented is an individual choice. That depends on the patient, surgeon choice, to some extent on the bone morphology. Like in a old patient, wide osteoporotic bone, using a non-cemented would be difficult because I'll be ending up using a largest possible non-cemented stem, which has to engage in the medullary cavity. That is, I have to go far away. And at that level, if the cortical bone is thin and I use the largest possible medullary, you know, stem for a femur, the stress change between the stem portion and unstem portion is so big that this patient probably will develop fracture in that area. So then I would rather use a smaller stem, which is cemented one. It's a good quality bone. I don't mind using a non-cemented long stem. So that's the individual choice and a condition of a patient.
Tackling cysts on table, what would be your take, sir? Large bone cysts, contained defects. How do we tackle
again the bone contained cyst? Yeah. It's the same thing. The bone cyst in condyle is not involving the box area. The box is intact, and the condyle is otherwise partly defect, having a cyst. I can excavate the cyst. It has peripheral, you know, lining of a bone, and I can impact it with a cancellous graft, and it has not affected the integrity of my box cut. Then I would not use a stem, because cementing the box area of a posterior stabilized knee is adequate stabilization. But if you are using a CR knee, which doesn't have a box, and then you have got a large defect in a condyle, then that condyle defect you have filled up with a bone, either a mosselized graft from the patient's removed bone, then the surface cementing may not be adequate because there is no box there. Then right. I may would like to use a smaller stem to give added stability. Usually the box itself in a posterior stabilized knee, if you cement the entire box, which is normally not done in a primary case in a good quality bone, but in these cases you cement the box, it has got adequate stability, almost as good as a small cemented stem. So if the box is damaged, the box cut is open because of either a defect or the graft or cavity, then you have to cement it. Now you have to add a stem to cement it.
Stem. That's right. Fantastic.
So for these kind of patients who he showed in the case who are, you know, not walking much, they're osteoporotic, they have some muscle atrophy, post the TKR, would you brace these patients? Would you?
Yeah, all the brace.
Yes, like a knee brace. You would give them a knee brace, and for how long would you keep a knee brace on for
Number one, the knee brace is given if the muscle power is less and a patient doesn't have full extension. Till the patient has extension lag, I will use a brace for that patient. And it could be anywhere between 3 weeks to 3 months, or maybe 2 weeks to 3 months, depending on the patient's ability. The osteoporotic bone, I don't think I'm worried about it, because the brace doesn't take care of osteoporotic bones. If the bone is my concern, then I would rather use a longer stem for a better fixation.
Great case, Dr. Umesh.
One of the next case, Dr. Aditya.
I'll just share my screen. Just 1 second. So first of all, thank you so much, Anoop, and specifically BOSN Ortho TV to organize such a forum. And it is actually a privilege to actually learn from Dr. Bhindi, sir. My presentation today is a little different from the infection and the complex TKR that we've talked about. It's actually a complex primary TKR, but it is totally replacement when there is an extra articular deformity. So the case that I want to talk about, she's an 80-year-old male patient, pain in the right knee. All the signs of primary osteoarthritis while turning in bed, few steps, sitting to standing, stairs, and affecting daily routine. He has history of a fracture femur in the past, treated with cast immobilization, normally fit and well without any comorbidities. So this is what the knee looked like. So there was a massive recurvatum deformity in the distal femur. There was joint line tenderness on both the sides. Clark test was positive. There was a varus deformity. There was a fixed flexion at the level of the knee. Plus there was a sagittal plane deformity in the distal femur, which was a recurvatum. The range of motion was from 10 degrees fixed flexion to 90 degrees. So this is what the x-rays look like. So there was a 38 degree recurvatum deformity and there was a 38 degree varus. So this is where I was confused when this patient actually had come to us. This was early in my fellowship. And so there was three options that we had. So there was TKR with asymmetric resection, there was TKR with an osteotomy, and there was distal femoral replacement. Everything had its advantages and disadvantages, but the review of literature basically made me choose doing TKR with an osteotomy at the same time. So this was what was done. So an open wedge osteotomy was done in the same knee incision. The osteotomy was bridged by a distal femoral nail from Smith and Nephew, and a navigated total knee was done in the knee. And this gap was filled with bone graft. And this is what the post-op x-rays look like. So they realigned in all the planes. And this is how the patient looked like after the surgery. So what was very important, or the outcome, or which made was the biggest learning point from the review of literature, which I had done at that point of time, was when to do what. So in presence of mild to moderate osteoarthritis, it's best to do an osteotomy alone. Which and the osteoarthritis managed conservatively. But if there is presence of a deformity which is more than 20 degrees in coronal section, more than 30 degrees in sagittal section, and the rotations are more than 10 and 20, this was the threshold from the review of literature that we got. Because if the deformity is more than this particular degrees, then it actually violates the collaterals, which was dictated by a paper from Wolf. So this is how we solved this problem in terms of TKR and extra-articular deformity.
Thank you. So great. So again, a very important topic about extra-articular deformities. I guess there's a paper by Dr. Pally and Krakow, if I'm not wrong, that dictates of where is the site of the deformity as far as the core and how much it can affect your knee alignment. Dr. Bhende sir, what would be your take? Similar patient, would you first do an osteotomy fix and then?
Can you go back to the? Can we open the presentation again?
Presentation.
Sure, sir. Sure,
and
sir.
Go back to the post-op X-ray.
Sure, sir. Just give me a second.
He has done a CR knee navigated with a supracondylar nail.
Okay, that's fine. Now, just tell me, if the osteotomy had gone into non-union, what would I have done?
Sir, it was...
What is the chance that the osteotomy done for a deformity correction goes into non-union? Does it always heal 100% of the time?
No, sir. So, non-union is definite risk factor that it can definitely go into non-union, sir.
So, what would you have done if this osteotomy had gone into non-union?
So then it would have meant that I would have to do bilateral incisions, do a bilateral plating along with bone grafting again. That would be the only option left.
Keeping the nail inside? Suppose the nail has become loose and the nail started coming out?
No, so the nail had to be changed. So then the joint would have had to be opened, sir. So that is definite complication with the nail. So the other option was the
wood
that we use for the...
box which is there, the intercondylar box in this femur,
yes sir,
and see where the nail will exit. Does the nail exit line coincide with the box which is there, or would it get hampered by the anterior flange?
No sir, it could be removed. So this was a striker knee, and the box was big enough to allow the nail to be removed if at all it had to be done in the future.
I don't know, but I would be very uncomfortable to do a nailing first, which is entering from the femur, and then put a TKR so that I am basically closing my opening and hoping that I am going to be right all the time.
Sure.
What I want to mention that is it has worked well and you are very happy and patient is happy and you are all lucky. But I got two such cases which has come to me for a second opinion from some other surgeon, where they have done the similar thing. They have put an intramedullary nail and done both the things together. And then they have put a knee, and this osteotomy had gone into non-union. Then it started developing varus deformity. The nail started becoming loose. The screw backed out. And this implant did not allow. Because see, if you may feel it is coming very well easily, but sometime, even say 2-3 millimeter mediolateral shift of that implant or this thing direction, it will just block the implant, you know. You know what I mean?
Yes,
you have got a very limited area there. And that area, unless you get a direct access along that red line, if the implant may not come out.
Yes, sir.
And then you are in a position to, you have to revise the knee. For what reason?
So,
I have seen two such cases where failure has come, and that's why I'm asking you, because this is probably not a right thing to do. Although it has worked very well in this case, you and the patient are lucky. But if it doesn't work well, if the osteotomy goes into non-union, then the patient will be in a much, much bigger soup.
So the choice of implant...
My suggestion would be to just fix the osteotomy, let it heal, then remove the implant and do TKR.
Okay, sir.
Sir, how about shortening and docking it and preventing the opening wedge? I mean, would that affect the knee biomechanics by any which way by causing a patella?
Anup, whatever you may do, you as a trauma surgeon, can you give guarantee that all osteotomies you do will heal?
No, better chance of healing would be with a
surgeon
docking.
Gives guarantee like that, I'll be very surprised. Either we haven't done enough osteotomies or you have been extremely lucky in your practice.
I think you're absolutely right in terms of the choice of implant, sir. So then how about plating it at that time? Because plating would increase the chances of union, or would that still be as bad as a nail?
The problem with the plating is you can do plating. You can correct, osteotomize it, do the plating, and now the plate is outside the implant. So you can do the implant, the TKR. That is not a problem. Here, what is happening is you are, number one, is unnecessarily increasing the complexity of your operation, right? How many patients are unhappy of a TKR?
So 5 to 10.
15 to 20%, right? That is a primary TKR. Now it is a difficult case. You have to do osteotomy.
Yes,
that has to heal well. Then if it heals well, your TKR has to work well. So you are increasing your complexity for no reason.
Okay.
Maybe you can fat on your back. I mean, I'm being a little blunt for doing an excellent job. But when things do not work, and I've seen two such patients who are in a dire problem. Because see, that implant doesn't come out. You have to do revision. When you do revision with a non-union at the top, you may end up requiring an entire tumor prosthesis because that femur may not actually hold another implant.
And sir, one last question, sorry. Because the patient was 80 years old, what about using a DFR?
Sorry?
What about using a distal femoral replacement?
No, but see, it is not necessary to do a major surgery in one go. You can always explain the patient, I do osteotomy. It will heal, give 6 months. It is much smaller operation. After properly done osteotomy, you can mobilize the patient within 2 days. You have got a good fixation. Let him move around, walk for 1 year. Maybe some of his difficulty will go because it is probably because of a very deformed knee. The knee alignment gets normal. His pain may become a little less. Wait for a year, let it heal, then do a simple TKR. Rather than trying to do, there is no need to do everything in one go.
Yes, sir.
Very true.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Well, that's my opinion. I mean, surgery has worked very well and I congratulate you for that. But the only reason I said, because I've seen two similar cases with a major complication, both these patients required basically a whole replacement, you know, implant replacement.
So there are a couple of problems. So by putting in a nail, you could not use intramedullary jigs. So I had to rely on navigation. That's number one. So navigation was a tool which was a must during this kind of a surgery once the patient has been nailed. So actually, that was another complexity if we are in a situation where we don't have a navigation tool. So that was another reason why I would think of using a plate at the same. But my only worry with doing it in two stages is, sir, how do we manage the pain in between? Because the patient did have severe osteoarthritis.
See, the patient has lived with osteoarthritis for how long? How long was the duration of osteoarthritis?
Sir, 80 hai, to 10-15 saal to ho gayi.
Haan, to 15 saal agar osteoarthritis, if he has jiya hai, to aur 6 mahine saal mein kya farak padega? But remember one thing, if everything goes well, you are happy. But
yes,
things go wrong. This is the last patient that you see again and again in your clinic.
Yes, sir. I
completely agree with your take that we need to stage it. Now, I've done a couple of cases. Fortunately, maybe I was lucky. But what my take was on this particular extra-articular deformity that is close to the knee joint is, you do the osteotomy, just chop off and do a shortening by about a couple of inches, dock it, it's a transverse osteotomy, just put in your femoral stem in, like an LCCK, and do a short plate. So that gives a definite chance of, at least a realistic chance of uniting rather than having that, only an edge open.
Yeah, I agree with you because that will be more scientific if you want to do one stage everything and there is nothing wrong in it. But then your implant is one thing and your additional plate is other thing. If any one of them fail, like your additional plate fail, if you have got primary good fit with an intramedullary nail, intramedullary long stem, which has got a it has to be long stem and non-cemented, engaging the medullary cavity.
Yes.
If you can have that, nothing like it.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Great case. So great discussion. It was an exemplary and a lucid talk by Bhende, sir. I mean, his experience and way of teaching is phenomenal. A very sought after teacher of many generations of orthopedic surgeons, I guess, and for all the righteous reasons. So Jay, should we call it a day for today? You're muted.
Yeah. I think we can call it a night. Thank you very much, sir, for being a part of this session today. And thank you to all the three speakers for wonderful cases that you have shown. Quite a wide range of cases we saw today. You know, one was an infected joint, one extra-articular deformity, and one, stem used in a TKR. So, quite interesting.
So, sir, and it's a sheer pleasure to have you on board. We look forward to further such interactions. I mean, we definitely learn a lot from your talks and your discussions as well. Thank you. Really appreciate your time.
Thank you, Anup. And thank you, BOS. And thank you, Ortho TV.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Really good cases. Really good cases. All of you have shown excellent cases. Wonderful.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Bye.
Good night. Thank you all. Bye.
Good night. Good night.
Good night, sir. Bye.
Good night.
Dr. Shyam, are we off?
Anup, sir, thank you so very much.
Hello. Yeah, thank you. Good night. Had a nice time. Very good presentation. Thank you.